very rarely am I speechless when I visit facilities. This one has me lost for words. I thought that was a room. I didn't realize that was part of the system that moves.
That's the shuttle. Every week we are building 10 machines.
10 machines. 10 machines, yeah. This is one of the craziest parts I think I've seen since walking in here. I feel like I'm about to have a stroke trying to keep track of all these spindles going. This is insane. We are here to check out some of the craziest machines you've ever seen. We're going to be checking out 5-axis machines, horizontal mills, dual spindle machines, and some of the craziest and largest automation you've ever seen. Come on, let's check this one out.
So here in Midland, we have 6 office buildings and 15 production halls, let's say, including our own manufacturing, but also running off our machines. We are at the moment a little bit over the 6,000 employees. Worldwide, we are at 9,000.
9,000.
Absolutely. So this is our own fabrication, our manufacturing of our small parts. This is a very good opportunity for us also to test new developments on a volume production level.
But on either side of us here, there's material and there's parts.
We have to make sure that the supply chain is always good, that we have all the parts ready on site when we want to assemble the machines, and therefore we are running here in 3 shifts all the time. So what we also have when we want to automize single machining centers, we have an addition to that when we want to automize also multiple machining centers in one automation. So this is the reason why we developed also our linear pallet storage system, or PSSL, like you see just in front of us.
This thing's huge.
That's huge, yeah, absolutely.
I've never seen a pallet system that has a man-sized door, and that's why, oh my.
So you see the shuttle moving up and down the aisle. On the left-hand side, we have our machining centers, so we can add up to 5 machining centers. On the right-hand side, you see the shelf with all these different pallets. Depending on the height of the pallet, including the work part, we can add multiple layers in there. We also have here our own developed pallet management system, which is taking care that always the right work part with the right pallet is going to the right machine, and that in the end of the day, the right machines are produced at the right time. So this is also part of our own manufacturing hall, but this is more dedicated to the medium and to the big size parts. And what we see over here, this is an own GROB development we did more than 10 years ago. It's our so-called GP2050 system. So in total, you see here 4 machining centers, which we, as mentioned again, developed for our own purposes. So it's 5 and 4-axis machining centers where we can place big parts in there. And the nice thing here is that we have this shuttle system, which is going up and down the aisle and is feeding the single machines with the work parts, with the pallets, placing it to the pallet storage system, placing it down further the aisle to the CMM room. And also here, fully automated. We just have operators to monitor what the machines are doing, but in the end, it's fully automated and controlled by our ERP system.
This is crazy. Like, you can see right there, it's picking up a part. Like, that's what's doing that. It's hard to get your head around the fact that this is all that integrated. And then also, like you said, it feeds into your ERP. Yeah. You could schedule this thing for 3 months if you wanted to.
Exactly.
And again, when we're talking parts, you know, we're not talking parts, we're talking parts.
Absolutely.
This thing's huge.
This is, for example, a part that we will see later on as well, because this is the let's say, the raw part, the raw body of our tool magazines for the machining centers. So make a picture. We will see this later on in the machine.
For just your tool magazine,
yes.
You start with something this robust.
Yes, absolutely.
Wow.
And the nice thing here is that inside this manufacturing cell, the only thing that is shifting the parts around is not like we see it here, the forklifter who's bringing the rough parts, because as soon as the parts are inside the pallet storage, then this shuttle system over here, our FMS system, is taking care of the transport.
Oh my. The fact that this thing can move around parts that size. Look at this, the whole thing.
There we go.
I thought that was a room. I didn't realize that was part of the system that moves.
That's the shuttle.
It's very rare do I look at a setup and not be able to identify that room I'm seeing down there is actually movable and part of the system.
Yeah.
I understand why I start to see traffic lights around here now, because you could get run over by that if
Absolutely.
You guys didn't have the safety measures in place.
Absolutely. So this is the pallet storage in here. So we have in total, we have a space for up to 8 pallets. At the moment, you see some of the pallets are not inside here. That means they're running in the machining centers.
This whole thing is a factory all its own, just this system.
This is the reason why we built this one more than 10 years ago, because we have seen there are such big work parts, which we are producing all the time, every day and every day. So it makes sense to automate this one and just run them the whole week. This is, by the way, the trunnion we have seen in the technical application center on this G750 machine. So this is how it's looking separated from the machine.
And look at the amount of detail that goes into these things. I know that's the big one back there, but like the amount of machining these things actually require, it's not simple. Very rarely am I speechless when I visit facilities. This one has me lost for words. So this thing, I take it, will go and automatically pallet change those things into the machines as the job needs them.
As you see over here, there's again a shuttle in there. We had to redo our basement a little bit. So there's also a shuttle in there, which picks out the pallets from the warehouse, places it into the machining centers, and so on. So it's a pick and place system with a shuttle.
And it's literally on a railway.
It's on a railway, yeah.
My.
And we had to build this nice trench in the concrete, but big parts need a lot of space.
I don't even want to know how many feet of concrete you need under there to be able to hold this much weight.
It goes down by 5 meters.
5 meters?
5 meters, yeah. So what we also do in here is we are manufacturing our own machine racks. So the whole basement of the machine.
Oh my.
And this is what we see over here on our Waldweg Coburg. Also, this machine now is almost 30 years old, but it's also running the whole week in several shifts. So what we see at the moment inside there, this is the machine rack of our G750 machine. Originally, this machine is capable to handle 20 tons, but we already tried it with 40 tons and it's still doing good.
So it'll do 40 tons.
We already put 40 tons on it.
Holy, would this thing be running pretty much all day, every day?
Every day.
Look at the rain of chips coming off that.
There you go, yeah. You can imagine that such a big part like this one takes a couple of hours until we have machined it. And when you want to run, or when you want to manufacture 10 machines per week, this machine is running the whole time.
This is absolutely crazy.
And this is not even the biggest machine rack that we are producing on machine. Also for our G920 machines, we are running our machine racks on this type of machine. So there's a lot of work for it.
And you know what's really crazy? It's hard to get your head around when you look at this, just how big that workpiece is. That cutter must be, I don't know, 6-inch diameter.
I would say it's around 320 millimeters of diameter, yeah.
As an imperial man myself, I will say yes. But the chips coming off that are just absolutely massive. Like, it's, unless you're standing here, you think you're looking at a much smaller machine.
It's also our philosophy is that when we produce our machines in our global plants, we want to make sure that the product and the quality is exactly the same. So this is also the reason why we have this machine also in our other plants. We live it that way, that we run or that we produce these parts worldwide in the same way, on the same machines, on the same fixtures. This is also dedicated to our, I would call it high volume production for our own machines. So what you see over here are parts. This is the housing of our set axis.
Oh,
so
I see.
All our horizontal spindles are assembled later on onto the set axis rack.
Yeah, that's literally where that thing comes in, correct?
Exactly, yeah. So this is the front end, so to the machining room. This is the rear end, where you can also retract the spindle for maintenance purpose, for example. So what we see here is a gang head or a milling head.
No.
So with multiple milling cutters in there, all of them have a fixed dimension to each other. And this is exactly the dimensions we have also on our drawings and our part prints for our own components. And you see just with one pass down in the X-axis, we are manufacturing all the different surfaces of this part.
That's so ridiculous. Is it doing both sides at the same time?
It's doing both sides at the same time. It's two machines face to face to each other, sharing one machine.
I mean, it kind of feels like it's about 8 machines in the same machine. Look at that thing. And those are large diameter cutters doing that.
Absolutely, that's heavy duty.
So that thing's, it's kind of like pinch milling in a way. By machining both at the same time, it's kind of putting the pressure on both sides. Oh my.
Absolutely. But of course, in the first station, we do the surfaces. The next station, we have to drill the holes and the taps. And because of the different machine types, we are, let's say, supplying these parts to later on. Some of the boring patterns are individual, depending on the machine type. So in this area, you see it over here, we have 3 machining centers assembled together to one special purpose machine. So one part in the middle, 3 machining centers. Each of this has its own tool magazine. And there we can do all this, the individual features on this part, like drills, like taps, like reamed holes and so on, index holes, pin holes.
I feel like I'm about to have a stroke trying to keep track of all these spindles going. This is insane.
This is insane, but this is how we do high volume manufacturing of our own parts here.
I feel like my brain just set on fire. That is absolutely nuts.
You're a machinist.
Well, yeah, well, I thought I was. I don't know if I am anymore compared to that thing.
So this is our test bench area. In total, we have 4 test benches. So what is also special at GROB is we are building our own motor spindles. And of course, every single motor spindle that we have built, we have to make sure that we deliver the perfect quality to our customers. So all the wooden boxes you see over there, in every single of these boxes, there is a motor spindle in there. And this is also our guarantee to all of our customers. When they buy a machine at GROB, we always make sure that there is enough stock spindles here in Mindelheim or for example, in the United States or Mexico or China or India or Japan, wherever our customers are.
And I mean, it's hard to even get the scale of this in person, let alone what's probably going to show up for the audience. But this place is huge. Everywhere you look, you guys have machines doing something. What kind of machines are these over here?
This area over here, this is our R&D test center. So especially behind this white wall, there's all the stuff that you can see in the next couple of years, I would say. So all the new developments are getting tested down here. And of course, also here, our liquid metal printing again, and other solutions like automation.
So if I go to jump that wall, will security tackle me?
Oh, absolutely.
Probably.
There is a grizzly bear behind
me. Well,
the
I tried.
So this is also, I would say, pre-acceptance area, debugging and commissioning of the machines before we send them out to our customers. In this area here, we are mostly focused on universal machining centers again. So the single spindle machining centers, 5-axis, 4-axis, including, for example, additional tool magazines, additional automation solutions, like in this case here, a pallet storage system or robot systems or linear gantry systems.
But when we're looking and we're seeing these machines here, if you had to put, you know, a percent on it, what percent of that machine is made right here?
So our vertical integration is around 80%. So we always try to do things by ourselves. We have an official machine tech, we call it. So every week we are building 10 machines.
10 machines.
10 machines, yeah.
Now, a lot of these parts we're seeing around here that are in this the tech center, these are parts that are being done obviously on the machines kind of right here.
Absolutely.
This is one of the craziest parts I think I've seen since walking in here. We got thin walls. I don't even know how you could get under that with a cutter, but yeah, these things are doing it, making it look easy.
I would say this is one of the unique selling points that we have on our GROB machines. This is the 5-axis simultaneous characteristic that we can handle with this machine. Of course, such a part like this is running not only for a couple of minutes, it's running for hours and days, so it takes a long time. But in the end, the surface quality, the finish and stuff, this is what our customers appreciate on our machines.
Am I allowed to step on the patio?
Yeah, sure, sure. So all our machines are horizontal, machines, and all of our machines have this, we call it the GROB cross slide and GROB tunnel concept. That means the Z axis is in a kind of a tunnel and the Z axis moving back and forth. The Y-axis is in the work part, so we can move it up and down. X-axis again in the spindle, and the rotation axis also again in the work part. And this allows us, for example, to machine the parts hanging upside down, so all the chips and the dirt is falling down into the chip conveyor. And of course, we have always the center of gravity of the machine is always on the same level.
The other thing that's really cool about that spindle actually going all the way back is when you see a big 5-axis machine, a lot of times you're limited by where the spindle starts. That's your workpiece size. With it completely out of the way, you're getting, although it's the same size as some machines I've seen, you're actually getting a lot more workpiece size out of it.
So this is our hall number 13, which is our biggest building that we have here in the plant and also in the GROB group. So it's more than 40,000 square meters and almost 300 meters long. And what we do inside this hall is the pre-assembly, let's say, and the sub-assembly of machine components. And also what we do in this hall is we are running off processes of our customers. So we have all these separate aisles going down the path with the, let's say, the sub-assembly groups, like, for example, coolant systems, like rotary tables, like controls cabinets, fluid cabinets, and also tool magazines.
It just goes on and on and on.
It goes on and on.
Look at this. Like, I've been looking this way. You can park 30 jumbo jets in here and still have room for a 31st.
Also, what we see in here is we tailor everything in the way how our customer wants it. For example, like you see here, paint specifications from our customers. We do whatever they want.
Somebody wanted a nice green.
If they want to have this Miami color here, they can have it. If they want to have sparkles in there, they can have it.
Don't tell me that, because I'll order one with some good gold flake in there. Make a disco machine.
So all the way down now in this area or this aisle, we have the tool magazine manufacturing. Means we have on this, let's say, flat racks or production tools, the orange ones. We are assembling already the tool magazine as a whole sub-assembly, as a whole group of components, before we lift them later on onto the machine base, where this, let's say, the final destination of the assembly.
And that's that giant part that was getting machined earlier that we saw, the big round one, the ring.
Exactly. After we have seen the sub-assemblies, we're going to the final assembly of the machining centers. That means, in our case, every single customer machine has its own spot where we build up the whole machine exactly at this spot. And as soon as the machine is, let's say, final assembled, it depends on if it will be directly shipped. So it leaves this spot here and goes to our logistics area. Depending on if it's overseas, we put it in a wooden box or put it on a truck, whatever.
When you see all the moving parts, you see the tool changer, you see the spindle with that entire ram that goes back. These look like nice white boxes when they're done. Under the hood, they're very complicated.
That's usually what you don't see behind the scenes.
I'd be afraid of getting lost in here because I feel like I may never find my way out. Ooh, I hear a machine making some big cuts.
Absolutely. So this is really the area where we play the music, where we are running off customer parts, where we are cutting chips. And we see here also double spindle machines or twin spindle machines in this case. We see single spindles. We see parts like extruded aluminum. We have casted, die casted parts, low pressure casted parts, cast iron, CGI, whatever our customers want a machine, we do it.
Wow.
And what is also special in this aisle here now, all the machines that you see now down the aisle are our own equipment. And this is also how we support our customers, especially the customers in industries like automotive, where they have a lot of pressure to deliver first parts on time. But for example, they have to deliver already first batches of parts after a couple of weeks or something. What we do then is we take our own machine, put a fixture on it, and we run parts for our customers to help them out.
Prove them out for them, you know, then they can put in the machine they want, exactly. But they can get that first article done.
So this is also one of our customer projects at the moment for a battery electric vehicle. It's a battery housing. In this case, you see our G920F4, which is a double spindle machine with two independent spindles. So it's more like two machining centers with own NC programs and own NC channels are fixed into one machine housing, and they're working together at the same time on one work part, one big battery tray. And in this case, we love to do our own linear gantries, but we also provide solutions like this one here. This is a robot on a rail going up and down on this overhead aisle and loading the machines from the top through the roof door. The big benefit here, it saves floor space on the concrete and also for maintenance and for operators. You can always walk around the machine. There's no limitation, nothing let's say that's blocking your access to the machine.
You don't need to climb in the automation just to change your oil.
Exactly.
So we actually walked under the road there.
Absolutely. So welcome now to the origin part of our plant here in Mindelheim. We started with this plant in 1968, but the company has been founded in 1926, so almost 100 years ago in Munich, but it wasn't the city center, not that much space to grow. So we decided in the 1960s, let's move outside of the city of Munich, and we started here with the plant in Mindelheim. In the very, very beginning, we started, for example, with gearing machines. We started with tapping machines, tapping mills, and then, let's say, after a couple of decades of experience, we started in the 1950s, 1960s with transfer lines.
Oh yeah.
Mainly for the automotive industry. And then in the 1970s, 1980s, especially in the 80s, we started with first machining centers and CNC controlled. So I would say we are part of this industry since day one.
Literally, you've been building some kind of machine tool or solution since the 20s.
Yeah.
My. So there you have it, guys. Thank you very much for joining us on this leg of our Bavarian journey. And as always, make sure you like, subscribe, and turn on notifications below to make sure you never miss a video. Thank you very much for watching, guys. You take care.